Welcome back. Now for reactions of phenol, the first one we're going to see here is nitration of phenol. Nitration involves phenol reacting with HNO3 in the presence of H2SO4. Now when this reaction takes place, we get two products. One of them is this is an OH, and then that's NO2. So this is called autonitrophenol. This compound is steam volatile, but the other product is not volatile. We have that one as OH and then O2N. That's actually the predominant product. So this is the predominant product and it is not steam volatile. So it means that we can actually separate these two compounds by steam distillation. So this is nitration of benzene. Those are the products it gives. Then there could be halogenation of benzene, like when benzene reacts with phenol. So when phenol reacts with chlorine, we get two products like this. This is OH and that's Cl. We call this autochlorophenol. And then we also have the para product. You know, we said before that when phenol reacts, you expect that you get products that are formed by substitution into the auto or the para positions. So in this case, we have our second product as parachlorophenol. Now, this one is the predominant product in this case. So you see that in the previous case, the para product was predominant, whereas in this reaction with chlorine, the auto product becomes predominant. What about reaction with bromine? When phenol reacts with bromine, the products you obtain would depend on the reaction conditions. For example, if phenol were to react with bromine in the presence of carbon disulfide as solvent, then you are going to get this OH, that's the phenol group now. Then you have bromine here in the para position, that's one product. Then you are going to get, surprisingly, a second product that looks like this. This is OH, then down there we have BR, here we have BR, and there we have BR. This is a tri-substituted product in the auto, and para positions. That was like 2,4,6 tribromo phenol. So we get a mixture of these two products. That is when we use carbon disulfide as our solvent. But if I were to remove this carbon disulfide and put bromine water, which is HOBr, then this first product you are seeing would be absent and would only get that tribrominated product. So for the reaction between phenol and bromine, what determines your product formation would be whether you are using carbon disulfide, in which case you have these two, or you are using HOBr, bromine water, in which case you have that only. Leaving the reaction with halogens, let's talk about some one or two other reactions of phenol. Phenol can react with HNO2. What is HNO2? HNO2 is dioxonitrate 3 acid. And when it reacts with HNO2, see what happens. So this is phenol. Our HNO2 may also be written as NaNO2 and HCl. Of course, if these two were to react, they would give us HNO2. So if we see this reaction like this, or we see it written as HNO2 on the arrow, it will be the same thing. And in that case, our product will be this. We have OH, and then here we have O2N. That compound is called paranitrosophenol. Nitroso is the name of the NO, sorry. This would be NO. Yeah, NO. Paranitroso. If it were NO2, we would have said paranitro, but this is actually paranitroso phenol. That para-nitroso phenol, upon reduction becomes OH and then H2N. That one will be called para-amino phenol. So para-amino phenol can be prepared from this reaction, although the initial product is para-nitroso phenol. When para-nitroso phenol is reduced, then we get para-amino phenol. Now, it is possible to, for this phenol, OH there, to react with CO2 and NaOH. Now, in this case, it's reacting with sodium hydroxide as well as CO2, and our product will be something like this. This is OH, and then this is COONA. See what has happened there? An alkanoate has been formed. So we have a hydroxy group, but this becomes the main functional group now. So that's like sodium benzoate with hydroxy on carbon 2 of the phenol ring. And then generally, when carboxylic acid salts are hydrolyzed, what do we know to happen? They become acid. So that hydrolysis of this, so let's put H plus there, the H plus standing for what now? Acid. When they are hydrolyzed, what do we get? We said we are going to get carboxylic acid. So I'm going to have my product here like this. OH and then COOH. This reaction, or this product rather, is known as salicylic acid. So salicylic acid is the product we obtain when we carry out this reaction. And this salicylic acid we are looking at is an important organic material in the synthesis of what we call aspirin. Aspirin is acetyl salicylic acid. So aspirin is a drug, and like I said, it's a derivative of this acid that we call salicylic acid. Beyond that reaction, let me make some space. The next reaction we want to look at here, okay, let's use this space now, is this. This is phenol. This time it is reacting with methanol. Methanol is HCHO, it's also called formaldehyde. And that reaction is occurring in the presence of sodium hydroxide. When this takes place, we are going to get two products that look like this. So we have our OH there, and then on this side we have CH2OH, and then this is one product with that. Then the second product is drawn as this. We still have the OH there. This time around we have, let me write it this way, CH2OH. Ordinarily, I would have preferred to write HOCH2, but now I have to write CH2OH. So we have these two products, again, auto and para. And this reaction, though not very, very popular, is called the Lederer-Manasse reaction. So the Lederer-Manasse reaction is what we are seeing there as one of the reactions of phenol. So when phenol reacts with methanol in presence of sodium hydroxide, we get two products, not one. Then, there's an important reaction we have here. This is phenol plus CHCl3. CHCl3 is chloroform, and this reaction too requires the presence of sodium hydroxide. So when phenol reacts with chloroform, we get a product that looks like this. So OH there, and then down here we have CHO. So that is the hydroxy derivative of benzaldehyde, 2-hydroxybenzaldehyde. This compound is formed from this reaction. And the reaction is an important one in organic chemistry. It's popular, it's named after two people. It is called the Riemer and Thiemann reaction. Riemer-Thiemann. So when we hear of Riemer-Thiemann reaction, this is it. That's the Riemann-Thielmann reaction. Then, moving beyond that, moving beyond the Riemann-Thielmann reaction, let's say the reaction between alcohol, phenol rather, and potassium iodide. Now, this one is what we talked about before, that alkyl halides can be converted into alcohols, and alcohols too can be converted back into alkyl halides. So in this case, when phenol reacts with Ki, we are going to get a product that looks like this. That's our ring, and then on this side we have the I. So what has happened there is the halogen, the iodine in this case, has displaced the OH group. If you watch the alcohol videos, you see something like this happening. We saw the alkyl halide being converted into alcohol, then we saw the alcohol being converted back into alkyl halide. Although this reaction would occur better when we use phosphorus halides like PCl3, PCl5, and SOCl2. We saw this under alcohols too. And we said for this kind of reactions, the best candidate will be thionyl chloride. And the reason we gave for using thionyl chloride then was the fact that the side products obtained with thionyl chloride are usually gases, and that they will leave the reaction vessel on their own. Alright, leaving that, the very last reaction of phenol we are going to talk about is the reaction of phenol with zinc chloride and ammonia. In fact, it's the ammonia that's reacting. We talked about ammonolysis when we talked about the similarities between phenols and alcohols. That was in the first video, phenols 1. We said that phenols and alcohols can both undergo ammonolysis. So it's that ammonolysis we're talking about now. So if I draw my phenol like this, this is phenol, and then the phenol were to react with ammonia, this reaction is taking place in the presence of zinc chloride. So ZnCl2, that is my catalyst for this reaction. So I would usually need 6 moles of ammonia if I were to balance this equation. Then I would have my product as NH2 there. This compound is called aniline. We mentioned before that aniline is also called aminobenzene. So this is the reaction that we call ammonolysis of phenol. That's the much we'll take for phenols. There are yet many other things to say about phenols, but we have to keep it this simple for relevance sake. Yeah, I'll put it that way, for relevance sake. So up next, you'd be seeing my videos on carbonyl compounds. Carbonyl compounds, that's where we're going next. So carbonyl compounds coming up next. So do well to subscribe, do well to tell your friends about this channel, do well to share the links to the different videos in this channel, and then very importantly, do well to see what we have for you under carbonyl compounds. Thanks for watching.